Hello, hello. I think we are live. If you guys can hear me okay, just let me know in the comments and we'll go ahead and get started. This is the Hexagon Mug Rug Workshop and you're here for day three. I know, days go by fast, right? So we're actually gonna hop on to sewing our pieces together. And if you did your homework from yesterday, you should have all your pieces basted, as you can see. Let me shift these over. You can see I have my hexagons all basted here and also my edge pieces. And remember in day one, we actually went ahead and marked these so they would be facing up in the direction that they were supposed to look so that they would match the little block chart here that I told you all to take a screenshot of. Yes, yes. Hi, Corinne. So glad to have you here. And if you're new here, just let me know where you're joining us from. And don't feel like you're falling behind. If you haven't been able to catch up on day one and two, you're okay. There's plenty of time for you to catch up. These videos will be up for a little bit longer, so you can take your time catching up with us. All right, so let's get started sewing these. Let me cover needles a little bit. My favorite right now are these. It's Clover Black Gold needles. They're applique sharps in size 10. But the reason I didn't want to tell you about needles ahead of time, needles and thread, is because I don't want you to go out and run and get a whole bunch of supplies yet. Whatever you have at home, just play with those. Because needles and thread, it's really such a personal choice. And I'm sure like all my little, like all my alumni students, they can tell you as well. You can try one, see if you like it. If you don't like it, try something else. You might like a whole different type of needle. Milliner's needles are really popular too. I like working with them as well. But the reason I'm working with these right now is because I can't bend it. Milliner's needles, I end up bending and so they become warped, but these, they don't bend at all. But experiment with your needles, and if you have just a regular sewing needle at home, that's all you really need, okay? And then I'm just using a 50 weight Orifil thread in white. If you have Gutermann polyester thread at home, that's okay too. When I did garment sewing, all I used was polyester thread. It's very nice and strong, holds up well for garments. You'll rarely see garments being sewn with cotton thread, and reason being that polyester is much stronger, right? Because we wear our garments and they wear and tear, and polyester thread just holds up. So if you only have polyester thread at home, you're okay with that as well. So I went ahead and got my needles threaded here ahead of time, so you won't have to see me like fiddle with my glasses, because when I have my glasses on, I can't see the eye of the needle for some reason. And see if you have any questions. Let me check the comments real quick. I think everyone's okay and you can hear me. Yes. All right. So what I'm going to do, I'm actually going to go ahead and start sewing the hexagons first. So I've already laid them out the way I want them. So I decided to play with orange. Not because orange is my favorite color, but I figured we started with orange yesterday, so I might as well just keep up with it, right? So I start with my center hexagon. Just gonna grab that. And then I'll grab one of the petals. We'll call these petals. They're the petals of the hexagon flower, right? So I'm gonna grab petal and I'll put them facing each other, right sides together. And remember this one, I thread basted yesterday too, but in general, I like to glue baste. But I just kept this one in the group here since we have it. And then make sure you have a little knot on your thread because you don't want it to fall out. And then we start in the corner. Like so. Can you see that? And then just come up. And what we're going to do is sew these together with the whip stitch. I want you to start with the whip stitch first if you're new to English paper piecing. Afterwards, you can experiment with ladder stitch and flatback stitch. and see if you like those better, but always start with whip stitch first. And then, but I'm gonna do another stitch here in the same spot in the corner just to secure my stitch. And then we want to make sure that when we sew these two pieces together, that the needle goes through the fabric at the top, but not too much so that you feel the resistance of the paper. That's why yesterday when I showed you how to glue baste these, you don't want the glue to go all the way to the edge. That's why it makes it really hard for your needle to go through. And then you're gonna be struggling and you're gonna get fatigue in your hand because you're pushing against something that has a lot of resistance, right? So then we want to make sure that it slides through smoothly and you don't want to snag it on the paper. You'll feel it as you go. So just take it slow. And I'm about, not an eighth of an inch away, but a little less than an eighth, as you can see here. Let's bring that up. Where's the camera? Oops. Let's bring it over a little bit. Hi, Kathy! And then you want to tug it on a little bit so you securely get your pieces together here. If they're too loose, when you open it up, you're going to end up seeing a gap. Like, you see those big gaps between teeth, and we don't want that. And then keep on going. And make sure you don't feel the paper. So it's right on top. Let me flip. Oh, there we go. So the needle should go through right on top, not through the paper. If you feel the paper, you've gone too deep with your stitch. Okay? But as you can see, I tug a little bit on my thread to make sure that the stitch is nice and secure. And just keep on moving. Hi, Cindy! How are you? I have a whole bunch of my alumni here from the English Paper Piecing Academy. So good to see you all. I missed you! And keep on going. Let's see. I'm going to keep on sewing across. And if you want to go ahead and sew along with me, that's okay too, because we're going to sew this whole thing together here. I'm going to finish the hexagon flower so that we can start sewing the edges to the hexagons. And now that I'm in the the corner here, opposite corner of the side that we started on, I want to do a double stitch here too to secure it. And to be extra safe, you could even go ahead and knot it. That way, if your thread breaks as you're working on the next side, the whole thing won't unravel. So I'm going to put a little knot there. And then we open it up. And do not cut your thread. You see my thread is still attached. Do not cut it. So we're going to take the next hexagon. And that's the way I wanted it, right? Did I flip it? Oh, yeah, we can have this strawberry facing out. So that's where I want the next hexagon. I'm just gonna put these two hexagons right size together. And then I come here. Remember the thread still left over here. It's still attached. I never cut it. But I'm gonna take a stitch here in the corner. And a second stitch to secure it in the same corner, and you could knot it. So let's go ahead and knot it just to be safe. Pull it through, wrap around the needle twice, hold it and pull the needle through, and now you got a little knot there. So it's secure, so even if the thread breaks, this piece won't come unraveled, okay? Now that that's secure in the corner, we'll just sew it across. Did everybody get a chance to baste their pieces? I know you were busy yesterday, Cindy. Were you able to catch up? Let's see, I'm going to sew this across. Not yet, hoping too soon. Oh yeah, take your time, Jennifer. Oh, work, Keith, you just got off work? Or are you at work? Dun dun dun. Kathy, you're basting. Oh, nice. Oh, you are at work. Sneaky, sneaky. Love it. I was gonna say, I'm gonna whisper. Oh, Oh, I'm sorry, Keith. Did you ch get a chance to pick your fabrics and get your pieces basted though? Or you still have to catch up? And Karen, you got them all basted. Awesome. Oh, and the sharing photo feature is on now on my Facebook feed. For some reason, I guess it was turned off. I didn't know you could turn it off. So I had to go and dig around a little bit. And it's turned on. So you should see a little camera icon under the comments under the video here. So you can add your progress photos. Because that helps keep me motivated too. Makes me excited to see how you're coming along. All right. So I went to the last second corner of the second hexagon and I secured it twice and put a little knot there. Okay. I'm going to open it up and move on to my third hexagon. And that's the way I want it. So I look and then I flip it over so they're facing right sides together. And I'm right-handed, so that's why I like to work from right to left. But if you're a lefty, you would just work opposite way, right? Yeah, sorry, Keith. Yeah, I had no idea that feature was something that you could adjust. Learn something new. But then Facebook's always changing, so I'm always learning something new. So I'm gonna do two stitches here in the corner again. And then the second stitch, I'm just gonna come up halfway. I'm gonna wrap my thread, not the piece that's coming out of the back of the needle, the one that's up top, and wrap it twice around the needle. Hold it against the needle so it doesn't tangle, and then pull it through, and then you have a little knot. Okay? And let me keep on going here. Okay. Oh, you got fabric choices. Nice. Awesome. All right. Fun, fun, fun. Did you guys see Margaret Morgan's pieces all basted, the one that I shared in the email? Isn't it so fun, those skeletons? Oh my God. I have to ask her what collection that's from. So fun for Halloween. Here. And after I finish sewing this hexagon, I'll sh open it up so you can see what I mean by making sure your stitches are secure. So I have one stitch in the corner, second one, I'm just gonna come up halfway, and the thread that's already at the top, I'm gonna wrap it twice around the needle, hold it against the needle, and pull through, and that's a knot. So now I got three hexagons sewn. And let me see if I can zoom up. See if I tug on it should be nice and secure, right? Tug, 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 tug. And you shouldn't see, you know, loose gaps in between. Okay, so now let's move on to the fourth hexagon. I want it that way. You flip it. And see, I keep on going with the same thread. Unless it breaks, you don't have to get a new piece of thread and keep on, you know, threading and knotting and redo that process. So I'm gonna come up twice. Second time I come up, wrap it twice around the needle and secure it. Oh, if your hexagons do not match up as you come towards the end here, let's say they're off a little bit, The nice thing with EPP is that it's quite forgiving. So even if you're up to like an eighth of an inch off, what you can do is just wrangle it a little bit, wiggle it, and make it so that it fits and just stitch it into place. Because once you take the papers out, it usually just relaxes into place anyways. So yeah, if you're a little bit off, that's okay. But preferably, yeah, if it's off a lot on all your pieces, then there's an issue with the basting portion. Remember when I told you yesterday, when you're basting your pieces, you want to make sure you feel the edge of the paper as you're folding the fabric over, right? Don't pull on it. Don't drag it, because then you're going to distort the fabric. But you want to feel it. There should be a little bit of resistance as you feel the edge and before you push it down to baste it down with glue. Hi, Joanna. You got your cardstock. Oh, it'll be up for a couple of weeks, so you're good. Hey, you ordered cardstock on Amazon, right? It got there fast. So you have plenty of time to catch up, Joanna, so no worries. But yeah, if you want to just follow along and get your pieces cut while I'm sewing, then that's fine too. And you can still hear me talking. Exciting! So no falling behind sadness, okay? You're good. And we'll keep on going. Oh, Tammy, you're doing a Christmas theme. Nice. Nice, I love it. You know, these will make like really awesome stocking stuffers. Mm-hmm. That's an idea. If you have any coffee or tea drinking fanatics in your family or among your friends, they'll all appreciate the nice mug rug. Keeps my desk from getting messy. And I'm going to grab my fourth hexagon. That's where it's going to go. I'm going to flip it over right sides together. And I still have my original piece of thread attached here. I'm just keep on going. Sophia, oh, you're making mug rugs for stocking stuffers? Yay! I know I had Christmas fabric somewhere, but I couldn't find it. It's hiding. Keep on going up this side. Are there any new fun Christmas collection out that you guys are waiting for, that you purchased already, that you're going to make with? I have to say, I do love smaller prints. So when I see the big Christmas prints, I get kind of sad, because then I can't really fussy cut for something smaller like these hexagons. Like, it'll look nice on a bigger quilt block, but big prints makes me sad. Just give me smaller prints. So notice how I take the needle back out when I feel like, ooh, that was not good. I felt the resistance of the paper, so I'll come back out. Reverse, and then redo that stitch. And I'm in the corner. I'm gonna secure that one with the little knot. Wrap it. And I actually think I can make a whole piece with one piece of thread. That's kind of cool. Doesn't always work out that way, but when it does, it's nice. And now on my last hexagon. And now you can see they are kind of getting in the way, right? So you could even fold this out of the way. And this is cardstock, so you don't have to worry about bending and folding it. Whatever makes it easier for you as you're sewing, right? And when I bend my cardstock like this, after I take it out or after this hexagon flower is done, I like to give it a good press, and the paper presses quite nicely too. Who would have thought you could press paper, right? Yeah, so don't worry about keeping all your shapes pristine. bend them as you need to. Like if you want this one out of the way, bend it too. That's why I don't like to use plastic templates. You guys might have seen those. I think they carry some at Joanne. And because you can't bend them when you're working with it. And I used my first set of paper templates that I made my samples. I used one set of papers for five mug rugs. And I just glue based. So you can definitely reuse these papers even if you bend them like I do here. And the reason I like to just sew all the petal hexagons to the center hexagon is so that I can get the placement like I wanted in place. And then also the sides. And this way, if you like to carry your projects around, like you know that this hexagon flowers is in place already, and you just need to sew the sides and you're good to go. I'm not gonna cut this, I'm gonna leave it as is. Unfold this one, see? They're all just attached to the center hexagon. But now since I'm here on this side, here, do you see the thread? Now I can just bend the center hexagon, I'll just bend it. And now I'm gonna sew across from this corner across here. And like before, I'll take one stitch, take a second, then knot the stitch there to secure it, and then we'll keep on going. Alright, so be honest, how many mug rugs are you planning on making? I thought I was going to stop at one or two, but ended up making five, and this will be my sixth one. But like I always say, you can never have too many mug rugs. Oops. I lost that one. I got re-threaded. Oh, this needle threader is like godsend. And it's by, if you haven't seen this before, it's by Clover. Can you see that Clover? And there are other brands too, I think, but I really like the Clover one. And you can find this at Joann's, Michael's, Hobby Lobby, Amazon. Sophia, you're gonna make at least two? Yes. Make them in sets so it's not lonely. Is it just where I am at, or has it gotten really cold all of a sudden where you guys are? Like the mornings are super chilly now. And I still have my thread attached here to the corner. But what I want to do so I don't have loose pieces of thread hanging out, I'm going to take this. I don't know if you can see it. The thread is still attached to the needle. I'm going to just wiggle it in between the seam allowance here and come up about half an inch in. Push it through. And then I'll cut it. So that way my loose ends are not sticking out on the end here. There we go. And then I would just continue sewing all the sides together. And this one's short, so I'm just gonna put that to the side and grab the next one. So I preloaded a bunch of needles. And now that we have the center hexagon done, what I can do is flip it. Let's say it's done. What time is it? Yeah. Do you guys want me to finish sewing these before attaching the edges, or what would you like? Let me know in the comments. It never gets cold in Phoenix, Kathy? like I'm up in the high desert too, and here we get snow in the winter occasionally, but we get frost in the mornings during winter, the winter months, and I can't leave like my aloe vera plant outside because it'll freeze, poor thing. And that's coming from someone that grew up in Europe, where we would have what it felt like 6 months of snow. Ooh, you're in Hawaii, Sophia? Nice. It gets humid there though, right? Chilly in Seattle. Oh, yay. You guys get a lot of rain there, no, Keith? Just finish this side, so I have two sides complete, and I can show you how to attach the edge pieces. Ooh, 50s. Oh, that's cold. Cold, cold, cold. Well, Massachusetts get cold, right? You guys get a lot of snow there too, no? Thank you. Gray and fizzy, then pouring rain. Ah. Well, at least you won't get soaked through that way. Okay, got two sides. So this way I got two sides that are secure, and I can, which one did I want to have on top? Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, we'll do that. So some winters, the snow can get carried away. Oh, yeah. About, I guess, 13 years ago, they had so much snow up here. Everyone was snowed in for 2 weeks because we don't have snow plows because it's not technically a snowy place. So no one was prepared. The freeway closed down. All the hotels and motels were packed because people couldn't get anywhere. That was kind of crazy. But back to this. So I'm gonna just flip it over so we can kind of picture what it's gonna look like so. Let's just imagine I finished all the sides here, and then I can take, let's say, the A1 piece, right? You guys can see that, okay? So then I'll just put those together, right sides together, just like we did with the hexes. And I'll start in the corner. Oh, and as you can see on my pieces, I decided not to baste the edges like I was telling you guys. You don't have to baste the outside edges like we talked about on the diagram here. Like all these outside edges, they're going to be hidden in the seam allowance, right? So I didn't want to baste them because I'm going to have to undo the basting anyways. So I'm cheating a little bit. It gets dark at 3:45 and sun doesn't rise until 9. Really? There too? Wow. So when I grew up in Sweden, when I lived in Sweden, during winter, winter time, we wouldn't get sunlight until like noonish, and then at 3 we would get pitch black again. So I would walk with the flashlight to school because it was so dark. Even with the street lights on, yeah. And it's like dead of winter. It's like, okay. But it's fun memories. But it does get depressing when it's so dark most of the day too. You can't tell if it's night or day. But summers were nice because it's like barely any dark time. But then it's hard to fall asleep because it's sunlight like for 20 hours out of the 24 hours. So you would need those curtains that block out the sunlight to get good sleep. Nice. I like that. Yeah. I like long days, Keith. So I'm almost at the edge end of my A2, A1 piece. And once I'm in the corner, I'm gonna do one stitch and do a second and knot it to secure. And I can open it up. So now I have my A1 piece done there, right? And I can go ahead and grab my, let's say, where's my thread? Oh, here, A1. So B1 it is. Match that up. I'm just gonna bend this hexagon out of the way. And just like I did with the hexagons, I'm just attaching all the edge pieces to the hexagon petals before sewing the sides, connecting sides. But you can decide if you want to sew the connecting sides first. I just find it easy this way, just so I don't get my pieces all confused and mixed up. Oops, see, now I broke my thread. But good thing was that I knotted my thread at the end of the corner of the A1 piece. So even if this is now unraveling, see how it's unraveling because I broke my thread, it will only go to the corner. So we're still okay. I don't have to redo two pieces. Let me match that up again. And so in the corner. We'll secure that with the knot. And go across. And does everyone have batting at home? Or fusible fleece? You just need a 10-inch square piece. Or if you have little scraps, you can zigzag sew them together, like Franken batting. Oops, maybe I should move it over a little bit. Almost at the corner. So Keith, now you can see that my corners don't match up perfectly here. See, the edge piece is a little off, but that's okay. I'll just wiggle into place a little bit like that and hold it and then match it up. So when I take the papers out, it'll look fine. Oh, to keep the thread from coming out of the needle. See how I have a pretty long tail? So it doesn't come out. So you don't want to have it too short and too close to the eye of the needle. That's when you're probably going to end up pulling it through. So you want a little bit longer. And as I'm sewing, I kind of holding it in place. I know you crochet, right? And you know how you hold the yarn in place with your fingers? That's kind of same, similar concept that I'm doing with the thread, the excess thread that I do here with the needle that's coming out of the needle. Sewing needle, I kind of hold it, see, between my ring finger and my pinky finger so that it won't slide out. Hope that makes sense. Yeah, see how I'm holding the tail end here in between. But you don't have to hold it hard. It's just you're bracing against it so you kind of feel it not so that it won't slide out of the eye of the needle. And play with thread length too. See what you're comfortable with. At what point is a project too big for fusible fleece? Oh yeah, for fusible fleece, I like to use it even for table runners too, but you don't want to do a whole quilt with fusible fleece. I wouldn't recommend that. So for up to table runner size, yeah. I've seen people make little baby quilts with fusible fleece, but I would much rather use cotton since fusible fleece is polyester, right? I would rather for babies and kids, I would rather use cotton batting. Yes, I saw your pieces on Instagram. You're very talented, Keith. Oh my goodness. I'm one of those crocheters that just jumps in and then there's a pattern and I get impatient and I just improvise. And then I had one side of the B1 piece done right here. But so I'm going to continue to the second side of the B1 piece. It connects with the next hexy. Do you see that? So then I'm just bending this cardstock here so I can line up those two sides. I'm going to do that again so you can see. So one side of the B1 piece is attached to this hexagon. The next side of the B1 piece is attached to the next hexagon. So I just bend my paper to line up these two edges. And my thread is still attached. Oops, and I tangled it here. And I'm just gonna sew across. But don't forget to place a little knot after you do your second stitch. Knot it, secure it. Let's see. And then we just sew across. And the more hand sewing you do, the faster you get. So if you feel like it's taking a lot of time in the beginning, that's okay. You're starting something new. And I swear you build muscle memory as you're doing hand sewing. Like your hands get used to holding pieces or little pieces of thread out of the way and working with you. See like how these look like they didn't match up, right? See that little corner of the white fabric peeking out? But then if I touch and kind of feel against the paper, I didn't baste this properly. See how it's loose? That's why it looks like it's not matching up. So as I get to that corner, I'll fold it in and then my corners match up and I'll just hold it in place as I do my stitches. Oh, I'm fast. Thank you. I'm like, I'm going so slow. I need to speed up. Let's see. And now I'm in my corner, do one stitch. Then do a second, and then we get knotted. Okay. Ta-da! So I'm working in reverse here, basically, right? But, and now I'm my thread still attached, and I can move to C1. And I'll fold it over, line up the two edges. Like that, and this B1 piece is getting in my way, so I'll just fold it so it stays out of my way. See, this is why I love cardstock. It's pliable but sturdy enough to make your pieces nice and crisp. And then we knot this and work our way across. And is everybody on Instagram too? I had someone earlier ask me, Kayla asked me what hashtag to use if you guys want to share to Instagram. So I said, let's just use Hexagon Mug Rug. I guess that's the easy one to remember. So if you are on Instagram and want to share and make sure I don't miss them so I can repost to my feed. Yes. I love sharing your projects. Yeah, I used to do the knots in a little, just one-handed way, but I want to make sure everyone can follow along and it's easy. And then just showing you how to do it, just wrapping around, I think that's the easiest and most straightforward way. You never go wrong that way either. So I'm in my corner. And bring it up. And then we have that knot. Got three pieces sewn on. So before I do D1, right? Here. So that on, I will want to finish sewing the connecting sides between the two hexes here. So I will secure this thread, go through the seam allowance. So let me pick this one. There we go. Now you can see the needle coming up further in. And I can go ahead and cut that thread, and we don't have any loose pieces of thread hanging out. So while I finish that side, let me know if you have any questions. Just gonna connect these sides so I can show you the deep piece, and then we got a quarter done, and you see how we sew all the pieces to the hexagons. So now you see how these mug rugs come together pretty fast. So for a quick project that you want to do in the weekend. Oh yeah, you'll never see the end. I knotted it when I got to the corner, Keith. And the reason I'm going into the seam allowance to hide it is because I just don't want the little loose tail to be poking out, and you have to tuck that in as you're working. But you'll never see that tail again. And even if it comes undone while you're washing, it's going to be hidden behind the fabric and the batting, so you won't see it. And you don't need to knot it, no. It's just like when you work in your loose tails on your knitting or crochet projects. You wouldn't knot it at the end, right? Yeah, you just work it into the project itself. So yeah, I knotted here. I'm gonna do it again so you can see. So I'll knot it because I'm at the end of the seam here. And open it up, and now it has a knot there, so I'm just gonna go in through the seam allowance, because if I cut it here now, I wouldn't want to cut it right up against the knot, right? Because then if for some reason that knot comes undone, technically this whole seam could come undone. So what I want to do, instead of cutting it here and have the loose bit of thread hanging out, I will just work it into the seam allowance a little bit and then cut it, and now it's just tucked into the seam allowance there. Burying your threads, is that what it's called in crochet or knitting? I know there's like a fancy term for it. I'm gonna go ahead and knot this. Now I can work my D1 piece and see how it's pointed. So one side, it's gonna attach to this hexagon, and the second side to the bottom hexagon here. So that's why I wanted to have the connecting sides side between these two hexagons sewn together. Okay. Open it up. And see why I don't sew the sides of the edge pieces, because how my fingers can come in between. And I can wrestle with these pieces easier. Ta-da! See? If this was all sewn together, I would either have to bend the whole thing, or my hands couldn't come through like this, right? But if this bothers you, you can bend it too. For me, this is okay. But let's just bend it for the sake of showing. Just fold it out of the way. And let's work on putting this D1 piece to the hexagon. And yeah, you can bend this hexagon too, out of the way. Weaving, sewing, or darning in ends. Ah, okay. See, I'm learning something new. So I'm gonna start in the corner, see it right there in the corner. And come up. I'm gonna do one more stitch and knot this so it's secure. You guys, if you have Instagram handles, share them here in the comments so everyone can check out each other's work too if you are sharing on Instagram. Because I know sometimes our Facebook handles don't match our Instagram handles. Oops, I broke my thread. See, well, it's a good thing because then I can show you. I'm going to get rid of this one because now it's too short for me. I'm going to take another piece that I got prepared. And if your thread breaks mid-seam, like this one did, see, it's in the middle of the seam, just leave the tail for now, hold it out of the place, out of place. And let's see, my stitches ended here. I'm going to go 2-3 stitches back and start over with the new piece of thread. I don't need to go back all the way to the beginning, just reverse 2-3 stitch lengths. And just secure this with the knot as if you were starting from the beginning in the corner. Can you bend the paper any way that works? Yep. Oh, bend the paper whichever way you prefer. Yeah. Whatever makes it easier. What I'm trying to say basically is your hands shouldn't do the bending over to keep this straight, right? Bend the paper and make your hands comfortable as you're sewing. Because I see too many people, they try to keep all the papers flat and pristine and they're doing weird claw hands trying to get in between. No, no, no. Your hands are going to get tired really fast that way. So bend the paper instead and make sure your hands are comfortable. These are our instruments, right? Our tools that we're working with, and we want to keep them happy. But I do know after a day of a lot of hand sewing, your hands do get tired regardless. But it should kind of glide through like butter. As long as you're not taking too much, grabbing too much fabric and not going too close to the cardstock as you're sewing, whip stitching your pieces together. Let me go ahead and knot that again. Knot, knot. Oops. And then I can open it up. And since I have this connecting piece of thread coming in up between these two pieces, I'll just go ahead and show you guys how to attach these two. And see, my edges have not been basted. If you did already, you're okay. But if you didn't, this is how it'll look. And I'm just gonna bend the hexagon so I can match up the two D1 and C1 pieces, the edge. And then I'll make a stitch here in the corner where they meet. Take a second stitch and knot it to secure. And then we'll keep on going up. And the reason I want to show you how to put so the two edge pieces together is so that you can see what I mean when you have basted all the sides of this edge piece. Get to the edge here. Almost. Was anyone planning on going to quilt market in Houston before it got canceled? So now you can see this is where my paper is, right? And my seam allowance that I did not baste because it's on the outside edge. And I'm on right at the corner. I'm gonna keep on going. And I'm gonna stop where the corner of the paper is and just make a knot. I'm not even gonna go all the way here. So the seam allowance will just stay open because I'm gonna trim that away after I fuse it to the fusible fleece. So you don't need to bother with that piece. Come through in the seam allowance. And I can cut my thread. I remember how I had to start a new piece of thread because it broke here in the middle of the seam. But because I went back three stitch lengths and started over, now this piece that ended up breaking, I wish I could see the back better. See how the thread's coming out of the middle, right? I can just trim it really close up to there and get rid of the little piece that broke because it's secured anyways. That out of the way. And now you see the sides sewn together, but it's open here where the seam allowance is. I didn't go all the way. I just finished where the paper ends. So if I fold it over, that's where you would sew to. So if you basted all your pieces with the edges basted over like this, too, glue basted or thread basted, then you would end, stop sewing right there, right? So same thing if you're leaving it open like I did, just stop where the paper ends. Because if you remember this one, see how it's not sewn together. But it fits perfect on the piece of fusible fleece. And I said you would need a, how big a piece did I say? 9 1/4 inch square. And we're gonna trim off the edges here to make it clean. So let's say for those of you, because I saw some of you actually finished this and they were all basted. Let's say I ended up basting these. Let me just show you what I mean. I think it makes more sense when I explain it this way. So technically, EPP, you would baste all the way around, right? So it would look like this. So you would sew this connecting side. And then when we take the papers out, we open all the seam allowances up, right? We would have to open it up to remove the papers. So you're gonna have to end up opening this anyways. But then the problem is if when you sew these, sometimes you'll end up sewing the seam allowance down and you won't be able to unfold it. So that's why I said just leave it unfolded. Don't even bother folding this down. That way you skip a step or two steps and it just makes it easier. But if you already have everything basted, you're okay. Just stick with that. And but then as you're sewing these connecting sides together, make sure to kind of wiggle these the seam allowance away. So you can just sew these sides, connecting sides together and not the seam allowance to each other. Does that make sense? I hope it does. Let me see if there, I know there's a little lag, so I'm gonna see if there's a question or any confusion if I made y'all more confused. Seems like you're all okay. All right. So now I hope it makes sense why we wanted to mark all our pieces like this so that we would know where to place them. If you do a quarter seam allowance, you would need 8 3/4. Technically, just stick with 9 1/4 for now, Keith. Because you can always trim off that little excess on the batting. Yeah, because the amount that I accounted for was with the 3/8 inch seam allowance. But yeah, you could get away with a smaller piece. Just do a 9 inch square, just to be on the safe side. The only time you want to be careful when you're fusing these, if the fusible batting is a little bit larger, like this, on the edge is a little bit bigger on the edges. You just don't want to run your iron over here because it's glue, right? So you don't want to get that on your iron, and you would just trim it down to the square size of your little patchwork top. So technically, 1/8 inch, 1/8 inch. Oh yeah, so it would be a 9 inch square, not 8 3/4. 9 inch square if you're doing a 1/4 inch seam allowance, Keith. 9 inch square instead of 9 1/4. So I did a 1/4 of the pieces. So you have mirror images to sew together to the remaining hexes. And I think that's it for today. It all makes sense, right? So I'll just keep on continuing. You could even turn these over if it's easier for you to visualize now that they're all in their right spot. Let me just flip these. Like so. And that's how they'll all go together. So for your homework tomorrow, just sew all your pieces together. Oh, I actually like this. I'm not an orange fan, but I think I can come to like this. Yeah, it's growing on me. Yeah. So yeah, make sure you sew all your hexes together. Sew your edge pieces to the hexes and the connecting sides so that when we come back tomorrow, we have a finished piece like this, but you'll have all your papers in and we'll work our papers out together and work with the batting. Okay? And is there any way, any difference to finishing if you're using batting not fusible? Yeah, batting, you saw 10 inch square. If you're not using fusible fleece and you're using regular quilt batting, grab a 10 inch square because you want it to extend like so. Let's use this one. You want it to extend outside because we're going to go ahead and thread, you would want to go ahead and thread based or pin based your regular batting to the to your little mug rug top, patchwork top, right? And since it's not glued on or fused on, it'll move a little bit, so you want a little wiggle room. That's why I suggest 10 inch for regular batting and 9 inch for the fusible fleece if you're doing 1/4 inch seam, and 9 1/4 if you're doing fusible fleece. I mean, with the 3/8 inch seam allowance. Doi, let's return that. Back up. So 9 inch square for fusible fleece if you're doing 1/4 inch seam allowances, and 9 1/4 inch square if you're doing 3/8 inch seam allowance using fusible fleece. Either seam allowance, use a 10 inch square if you're doing regular batting. Love the colors of the one with the white background. Yes, I like this one too. It's little berries. All right, so I'm giving myself homework too. I'm going to finish these for tomorrow. Leave your papers in. Don't take them out yet. We'll take the papers out together and troubleshoot if there's any kind of issue removing your papers tomorrow. And I'll see you guys same time, same place. Bye.